Our television series, focusing on great living American composers, is a project born of this pioneering spirit. The idea of presenting significant American music in this way, some of it for the first time ever, has brought enthusiasm and support. San Diego's KGTV Channel 10 has contributed the entire video production of the first program, Appalachian Spring, and the composer of this Pulitzer Prize-winning and very beautiful score, Aaron Copland, America's preeminent composer and longtime advocate of the new in American music, graciously agreed to lend his support to the project as our first featured composer. He was 81 years old when we met for our interview.
The reasons we're here today are living American music and American composers. The San Diego Chamber Orchestra has committed itself to a series of special programs featuring the music of American composers who have contributed in a special way to American culture and American artistic life. And we're very, very honored to have with us today Aaron Copland, who's well known to American concert audiences and concert audiences all over the world. Mr. Copland, we're very pleased to have you in our studio today.
Thank you.
And this program features your composition, Appalachian Spring, which is possibly your best known composition. And it was written almost 40 years ago now. And I wonder if you could tell us what life was like for you in those years and what the special inspiration, perhaps, of Martha Graham was in the mm-hmm. composition of Appalachian Spring.
Well, I feel very lucky to have been a member of the generation of the 20s. I mean, the 20s are famous in a way that the 30s and 40s are not famous. I suppose the First World War having stopped most artistic activities, there was a big swell of interest and activity in the field of the arts during the 20s. And being 20 in the 20s, as I was a stroke of great good fortune. The only unfortunate part is that in the 60s, you're 60. However, there's no changing that, so one gets accustomed to the idea. But it was a very happy circumstance that I should have been around for the first time as a grown-up person, musically speaking, in the years 20 to 30.
There were some very special musical personalities in Paris during those years. And you were, as a young composer and music student, were aware of some of those people. Who were some of the people that
were
with
you then? Well, I had the great good fortune of finding a wonderful teacher in Paris. It says in some of the music books that I went to Paris to study with Nadia Boulanger.
I know. That's
not true. When I went to Paris, I never heard of Nadia Boulanger. But you know, once somebody publishes a thing like that in a book, it's hopeless to get it out. Other people just copy when they write books, and in the end, I begin to think maybe they're right and I was wrong. But that was a stroke of great good fortune because Mademoiselle Boulanger, well, she was a wonderfully trained musical figure. And the French don't fool around in their early trainings in any of the fields, and you get a really solid grounding, which she had. And she was also interested in the works of the younger men and what they were doing. Many of the fine older teachers in music tend to love their Bach and their Beethovens, but they can't seem to latch on to what the contemporary composer is writing with any enthusiasm. But that was very different of Mademoiselle. Not only did she latch on, but I, as a student, would meet the musical great of Paris in her studio. She had these Wednesday afternoons at 5, when she served tea, and I, an unknown young fellow from Brooklyn, suddenly I was shaking hands with Stravinsky. And that was a big thrill, and other famous composers, among the French especially, during that period. In fact, I can't imagine what my musical career would have been like if I had never met Mademoiselle Boulanger and studied with her.
Yes.
She died only last year, I believe it was, at the age of 92, and was active right to the end, taught I don't know how many students for more than 50 years, so that it was really a stroke of great good fortune to have happened upon her.
You mentioned the relationship of of that woman to the young composers and her interest in their music. And in a way, it seems that the music of that period was a part of life and a part of kind of cultural explosion in Paris. Today, musical culture seems to be somewhat separated from audiences, and audiences are often indifferent or apathetic about anything but established classics. In our world, films are a little different in that people are always interested in seeing the newest film. If we go to see an old film like Camille or Casablanca or some classic, we take it for granted that we're seeing an older film and we're going for a certain reason. Sure. But what everyone is interested in is the new films. You think it's possible that music might, in the coming years, develop a living relationship with life, something as you knew in the 20s? Or do you think...
you make it sound rather more pessimistic than it really is. We contemporary composers, I think, feel fairly lucky. For one thing, we have the medium of the phonograph recording. The older generation of composers weren't that lucky. If they wanted people to hear their music and they couldn't get it played normally by a symphony orchestra, they had four-hand piano arrangements and had to settle for that. But the fact that some of the better-known pieces of ours have been recorded and are distributed widely has simply completely changed the picture.
And you've always had a lively audience for your pieces. What has been the reaction of audiences, would you say, to your music over the years, and has it changed?
Well, in the beginning, of course, in the 20s, when I was, as I say, 20, I was thought of as quite a radical in music. I got consistently bad reviews in the New York Times because it was so modern, they couldn't understand what I was doing, and my father was very concerned. When he read these bad reviews in the Times, he knew nothing about music. He said to me, "These fellows get paid by the Times, they must know something about music." And I said, "Oh, Dad, don't pay any attention to them. They're all fogies and stick in the muds. They can't latch on to the new thing in music." So he just had to, acclimatize himself to that particular scene. But it was fun to be thought of as a young radical in music. I wouldn't have wanted to be, a nice, staid, proper Bostonian composer of the usual kind of symphony. It wouldn't have been as exciting as doing something that you thought of as rather daring, using rhythms that hadn't been used in that way before. And contemporary music is, of course, very famous for the rich rhythmical life that's been created in our own time. So that I think it was a lucky chance to happen to have been 20 in the 20s because of the fact that the First World War had stopped most of the, normal musical activities. There was that hiatus, and when the war was over, there was a surge of renewed interest in the newer things. And Stravinsky appeared on the scene, and Schoenberg, and the Group of Six in France. And I remember shaking hands for the first time with Stravinsky in the studio of my teacher, Nadia Boulanger. And I was got a terrific kick out of that. And I suppose now if I shake hands with some young fellow nobody's ever heard of, he might have something of a similar reaction. I hope so.
I was honored to shake hands with you a moment ago.
No, you're too old. You won't fit in the category I'm thinking about.
What was Martha Graham like? Was her spirit a unique spirit in Appalachian Spring?
Yes, and Martha is really somebody special. Extraordinary woman, wonderfully devoted to the art of the dance, and wonderfully creative and effective. She has her own school. She's developing other young dancers. Of course, she's too old herself to still be dancing. Really a wonderful gal.
As we move into this project of which we hope will be a pioneering project of music, featuring music of living American composers, perhaps we're going to get into unpopular or dangerous territory as we move through this. And of course, your music is featured on our first program. I wonder if, as you if you have any advice for us as we go through this this uncharted
terrain.
My
advice would be stick to your guns.